Hi there, and welcome to this lecture on process flow diagrams, equipment summary tables. My name is Marina Miletic. Selecting the tube and shell side fluids was the focus of our previous lecture, which was important because otherwise the appropriate materials of construction for the shell and the tubes of the heat exchanger could not be selected. Remember that materials of construction are not provided for you by ChemCAD or Aspen. You must select the appropriate materials for both the tubes and the shell by balancing cost versus the durability required to withstand the temperature and chemical exposure to the streams. Recall that when selecting an appropriate material, first narrow down the choice based on two factors. First, examine if the temperature of either stream going through the heat exchanger is excessively high or low, because these conditions require special materials. And second, look for oxidizers, chlorides, acids, bases, or any other reactive chemicals in the streams going through the heat exchanger. These will also require special materials to avoid reactivity with the heat exchanger. Once your choices have been narrowed down based on these factors, calculate the cost of each feasible option to make a final decision. Remember that we discussed 11 common types of materials used in chemical process equipment, which are listed here. The cost of these materials generally increases as we go down the list, but keep in mind this is only a general rule and the prices of these metallic raw materials can fluctuate considerably. For heat exchangers, there are two additional options you should consider to help lower cost. First, know that with heat exchangers, the tube side materials of construction can differ from the shell side materials of construction. One of the first things you might notice about this equipment summary table is that some of these shell and tube materials are not identical. You see this oftentimes when the process stream is under high temperature conditions or is reactive, oxidizing, acidic, or basic, but it's being heated or cooled by a fairly innocuous stream, such as water. Some people think that if you must use, for example, nickel or aluminum tube side because of extreme temperature conditions or potential reactivity, that the entire heat exchanger must be made of this material. Choosing to do this could more than double the cost of the heat exchanger. So if expensive materials are not necessary, avoid using them. Focus the use of expensive materials on the surface areas that will be exposed to extreme temperature or reactivity conditions. Second, consider using cladded materials if possible to save on initial heat exchanger capital costs. Cladded materials feature a more expensive material as a top layer, laminating a cheaper material below. Using cladded materials ensures fluids are in contact with a less reactive surface, but still have the durability and thickness of a cheaper material below. Keep in mind cladded materials should be inspected more frequently to check for material integrity and to be sure corrosion is not occurring. For our ethylene oxide process, I chose 316 stainless steel for E101's shell material because this stream is more than 99% oxygen and is a strong oxidizer. Remember that the compressor before this heat exchanger, C101, is also 316 stainless steel. I chose carbon steel for E102's shell material because it has ethylene gas flowing through it, which is not particularly reactive. I chose carbon steel for the tube materials for both E101 and 102 because these tubes have steam going through them, and carbon steel can withstand temperatures of up to around 500 degrees centigrade. I chose carbon steel as the material for E103 because it's appropriate for both the shell side cooling water as well as the fairly inert tube side process stream. For the freon cooled heat exchanger E104, I chose shell side carbon steel because the process stream is fairly unreactive and should not create considerable corrosion. I chose a special type of carbon steel for the refrigerant flowing tube side. This A201 steel is fairly cheap and works well for streams that are as low as minus 45 degrees centigrade. If this stream were even colder, I could have used a copper or stainless steel clad carbon steel. This is really only appropriate if the temperature is very high or very low. I recommend reading Peter Timmerhaus and West's book, Plant Design and Economics for Chemical Engineers, because it provides valuable information on the appropriate temperature ranges for a wide variety of materials. They also provide material selection recommendations based on the chemical components in your stream. The last pieces of information you should provide in your equipment summary table are fairly straightforward and can be found easily if you're using a process simulator. Include the flow rate of each stream, the inlet and outlet temperatures, the inlet and outlet pressures, and the phase of both tube and shell side streams. Most of this can be copied and pasted from the stream table. The phase designation is something you should interpret based on the vapor fraction of the stream coming in and going out of the heat exchanger. For example, oxygen and ethylene gases have a vapor fraction of 1, both going in and coming out of the heat exchanger, because they're both gases at this temperature and pressure, so they should be both designated as gas. High-pressure steam enters tube side in both of these heat exchangers as a saturated vapor with vapor fraction 1, and by the time it exits the heat exchanger, it's a condensed liquid, so this means these streams are designated as condensed. Cooling water enters and exits the shell side of E103 as a liquid. It does not change phase, so it's designated as a liquid. The process stream, however, goes from a vapor fraction of 1 to 0.8, which means it's partially condensed. The same thing occurs with the shell side process fluid in E104. Its vapor fraction changes from 0.2 to 0.1, which means it's partially condensed. The freon refrigerant in the tube side of E104 goes from a vapor fraction of 0 at the inlet to 1 at the outlet, which means that it's being completely vaporized. Notice that on this table, the fluid density of the shell or tube side fluid are not shown. This is because with condensing and vaporizing fluids, the density may be changing dramatically, so it's more intuitive to just designate the phase of the fluid flowing through the heat exchanger. This concludes the discussion of heat exchanger equipment summary tables.